Chapter 5. I would suggest that by the time I did the final day's filming on the final episode of Scrap Heap Challenge in the summer of 2007, the idea that I would ever be covered in rubber on Red Dwarf only existed in another time dimension, one inhabited by a far better looking version of me, a man of much greater intellect and charisma, a man who had eyebrows and the ability to see into the future with his psychic powers. Scrap Heap had by that time filled my working life for 10 years. I've no idea how many machines I witnessed being built. It is in the many hundreds. How many team members I met? Must be in the thousands. How many hours firstly Kathy Rogers and then Lisa, no relation Rogers, and I sat in rain, sun, mist or drizzle talking about them. How many amazing judges I spoke with, people who were leaders in their fields and who all took an immense interest in what was going on. Too many to recall without notes. In the 10 years from 1998 until 2007, I met the most amazing engineers, scientists, mechanics, and madcap bodgers, or in the USA, kludgers. Some brilliant, some bizarre, some just a little bit frightening, but all incredibly inventive and enthusiastic. It was through working on this series that I rekindled my interest in engineering, particularly in large renewable energy projects, and more directly in alternatively fueled vehicles. While I was working on Scrap Heap Challenge in California in 2001, I had my first ride in a hybrid car, the Toyota Prius. I didn't know what it was, and I wasn't interested when I was given a lift in one. This first-generation Prius belonged to a member of the production crew. To me, it was just a dull, faceless, and rather dusty car. It was only as we pulled away from a set of lights on Sunset Boulevard very late at night that I realized something was different about this entirely unremarkable-looking vehicle. It pulled away silently. It felt like it was being towed by a wire. There was no engine noise. "How did you do that?" I asked incredulously. The woman driving the car just said, "It's a hybrid." I didn't know what that meant. A hybrid? A hybrid what? Half man, half machine? It wasn't an explanation that meant anything to me. When she dropped me off outside my apartment in West Hollywood, I didn't invite her in for coffee. I asked her to pop her hood, which is a far more respectable request a middle-aged married man makes to a young female researcher. I soon surmised that under the bonnet, as we oldie Englanders would have it, was a petrol engine and an electric motor working in spiritual harmony. It was a pivotal moment for me. It may seem unremarkable and dull to most normal people, but for some reason that wonderful technological achievement got my imagination working overtime. Really, from that moment on, my whole life and world had moved away from being an actor towards being a kind of weird advocate of engineering education, and specifically alternatively fueled vehicles and renewable energy. That was until I got the call. "Darling, I've just heard from the Red Dwarf people," said my agent Maureen. "She's very dry. She doesn't get excited about showbiz shenanigans because she has to deal with them day in, day out. Apparently they want to make a new mini-series, darling."
"What, of Red Dwarf?" I asked.
"Yes, darling, a 3-part special for UK TV.
"What, now? After all these years?"
"Yes, darling. Plus they want to do something they're calling Red Dwarf Unplugged."
"Oh, Lordy, what does that mean?" I asked, immediately full of dread.
"I think they expect you to improvise a live show in a theatre, in front of an audience, darling."
"A what? A live show? Red Dwarf, in costume, covered in rubber, in a theatre? Has the world gone mad?"
"The world went mad a long time ago, dear," said Maureen flatly. "What shall I say to them?" So I talked to Craig and Danny and Chris and eventually to Doug. Red Dwarf Back to Earth was going to be on Dave, which for those of you outside the UK media bubble isn't a chap. It's a cable and satellite TV channel, and a very successful one. Dave showed Red Dwarf repeats on a regular basis, and had decided to commission a brand new 3-part miniseries plus a special called Red Dwarf Unplugged. Doug explained that the 3-parter was titled Back to Earth, and it was going to be made on a very minimal budget, and I wasn't allowed to say anything about it on Twitter. Doug was going to direct the shows, and I wasn't allowed to say anything about that on Twitter. Every description of the way we would work, or the storyline that Doug explained to me, always ended with the firm request, "Don't say anything about it on Twitter, Bobby." So, I didn't say anything on Twitter. I was very good. I kept shtum. I feel it's important at this point to remind you that the last time we recorded a series of Red Dwarf back in 1998, there was no such thing as Twitter or Facebook. There was barely the internet. I know I had a dial-up modem at home. I would occasionally sit in front of my hefty laptop and dial into the web. 3/4 of an hour later, I'd be online. An hour after that, I may have been able to download 2 or even 3 whole emails. By the time Back to Earth came to be, things had moved on. I had web pages, blogs, and nearly 20,000 followers on Twitter. I joined Twitter in early 2007 when I was working in Los Angeles. During that period, I went to some kind of tech party thing. I can barely remember the circumstances, but someone I met there asked me what my Twitter handle was. I thought they were being rude, assuming a Twitter handle was some kind of euphemism for gentlemen's downstairs frontal equipment. Once the cleanliness of the term had been established and the basic rudiments of what Twitter was all about had been explained, an enthusiastic young man signed me up for Twitter. He asked me what I wanted my Twitter handle to be. At that time, the crew on Scrap Heap had taken to calling me Bobby Lou, due to the fact that my current co-host was called Bobby Sue Luther. They found it amusing that she was Bobby Sue and I was Bobby Lou. Well, none of them knew how to say Llewellyn, so when someone suggested I call myself Bobby Lou, it all seemed perfectly fine. From that day, for maybe a year and a half, my Twitter account remained resolutely dormant. One tweet, a classic from the era, read, "What is this?" The next time I checked, maybe late 2008, I noticed I had over 5,000 followers. I felt guilty. These poor 5,000 people were waiting for me to say something. It's just rude to ignore them. So I typed, "Hello," and it's been downhill ever since. So Doug begged me not to say anything on Twitter. We were all sworn to secrecy. UK TV wanted to make the announcement on a specific day. It was all explained to us in great detail. Not long after we'd had all this explained to us in great detail, Craig did an interview on Radio Abergavenny or somewhere, and when asked if we were ever going to make new episodes of Red Dwarf, he said, "Yeah, we're making a new series very soon, lad, but it's all a bit, you know, hush-hush at the moment." He said this live on air. I'd say it was 20 or maybe even 30 seconds after the words left his mouth that the first tweet hit my mentions column. Within a minute, I'd received maybe 700 tweets asking me if it was true. I still didn't say anything. I didn't even tweet #nocomment. I let it be. I checked later that day and estimate, it's very hard to count tweets, that the questions were now in the many thousands. "Hey, @BobbyLou, just heard new #RedDwarf. Is it true? ?" I spoke to Doug. "I think it's just possible there's a chance people are quite interested," I said. I explained to Doug that I was about to head off to America to attend a load of meetings and record a few episodes of Carpool in California, the online show I record inside a Toyota Prius. I was also attending an event called DragonCon in Atlanta, Georgia, listed as the biggest science fiction fan convention in the world. A few days later, I was informed that I'd been invited to do an interview on KCTS television in Seattle, Washington State. KCTS is one of the PBS stations in America with a long tradition of showing Red Dwarf. I had visited Seattle with Craig in the 1990s, when we'd taken part in pledge drives and huge Red Dwarf events in that glorious city. I do love Seattle. There's no point trying to cover it up. I'm a lefty liberal, and I love Seattle. So, a few adjustments to the travel logistics, and it was all sorted. I was told by Doug specifically to announce the new series while I was there. I flew to America with my son, Louis. We stayed in a lovely old downtown hotel in Seattle. We went for walks in the rain. It always rains in Seattle. And we did a lot of sleeping, visited various skate parks and the original Starbucks. And then, after a couple of days, made our way to the KCTS studio. I talked about the new series we were going to make during an interview in front of an invited audience. I mentioned that we hadn't made any Red Dwarf for 10 years, and I couldn't remember how to do it. It was all very jolly. As the interview was broadcast live, the news spread with extreme rapidity. I started getting text messages as we walked out of the studio. Obviously, there had been discussions back in the UK. I was now being asked not to say anything. I laughed nervously. It was just a bit late. The Twitterverse went ballistic. I then visited a wonderful man called Leo Laporte in his studio in Petaluma, a small town about 60 miles north of San Francisco. Leo had been an inspiration to me and had convinced me to start making Carpool as an online series. We're the same age and both have a traditional TV background, only he now runs a multi-million dollar a year podcast company called TWIT, which stands for This Week in Tech. It's Nerdgasm City. Listening to TWIT is what keeps me in the loop, baby, pushing the tech envelope. You can easily find it online, and if you're the least bit interested in techie things, social media things, and all related topics, I highly recommend it. After leaving San Francisco, we flew to Atlanta, and I was immediately overwhelmed by the sheer scale of the event. As we waited at the airport, we were herded towards a large group of actory types, some of whom I recognized off various sci-fi shows. I'm not talking Leonard Nimoy or Sigourney Weaver. I'm talking about that bloke, you know, the one with the funny head in Battlestar Galactica. Because, after all, I was that bloke, you know, the one with the funny head in Red Dwarf. We were conveyed to the hotel in a large bus, and I was given an all-areas pass and a key to my suite. I had a suite, baby. Yeah, luxury. With a 14-year-old son who was determined to try every caustic, caffeinated, ultra-high sugar energy drink on the US market, something he was never allowed to do back in Blighty. "I want to see how long I can stay awake, Dad," he said to me with glee, just as I was trying to get to sleep. He had a kind of camp bed at the other end of the huge suite we were in. He moved the furniture in the night and made himself a little corner nest. I have no idea how he did it without waking me up, but when I climbed out of bed the following morning, I couldn't believe my eyes. Everything in the room had been moved. My son was out for the count. The one, and I say this with caution, the one advantage of ultra-high caffeine energy boost drinks is once they wear off, even my son, who has never done the sleeping thing easily, just hit the deck. On the first day of the convention proper, I found my signing table. It was situated right next to Mickey Dolenz. For those of you not old enough to know about Mickey, he is a legend. He used to be in the Monkees, a 1960s American version of the Beatles. Mickey Dolenz was a massive star at the time. Girls screamed when he walked down the street. Girls had pictures of him on their bedroom walls. I'm talking proper famous. He was very charming, but he did look a bit bored as he signed pictures for a huge queue of middle-aged women who clearly still loved him. I sat behind my table, a little forlorn. This was such a massive event. There were so many TV stars sitting behind tables in this huge cavernous hall, some of whom you'd all know, some of whom I'd put money on you never having heard of, even if you'd seen the show they were in. But they all had a queue of people waiting to meet them. I, on the other hand, had not a soul. To say this was embarrassing was to put it mildly. The other actory types had huge pictures behind them from the various movies and TV shows they'd appeared in. All I had was a tatty handwritten sign put up by the organisers with my name spelled incorrectly. I'd come all the way to Atlanta for this, when I could be at home pottering about in my garden. I crowned myself the Archduke of Numpties. Then a very nice man came up to my table. "Oh my God, it's Crichton from Red Dwarf!" He shook my hand with enthusiasm, and I signed a picture for him. And then he got his friend to take a picture of the two of us. I was thrilled. One person out of the 25,000 people attending actually knew who I was. He disappeared, and I stared in mild embarrassment at the hordes of people passing by to meet the girl who delivered two lines in a recent Harry Potter film. Half an hour later, stewards arrived to take control of my queue. It had got completely out of hand. It stretched out of the door and apparently halfway down the enormous corridor outside. The word had spread through the convention that Crichton was there. Twitter be damned. This was old-school word of mouth, the fastest non-digital communication system in the world. I glanced at Mickey Dolenz every now and then. He wasn't that busy anymore. His queue had diminished to a couple of very overweight but highly enthusiastic fans who kept asking him questions which he clearly didn't have much interest in answering. Naturally, I felt guilty. I signed pictures until my right hand had cramp. There is no question, Red Dwarf is very popular in America. Okay, let's granulate that data a little. Red Dwarf is very popular in the America that is keen on British comedy. Okay, let's find that down a bit more. Red Dwarf is very popular among the quite large proportion of the crowds at DragonCon, who are keen on British comedy. During my days at the Monster Convention, I also took part in numerous panels and discussions. All these events were packed to the roof. In the evening, we retired to one of the dozens of eateries dotted among the three massive hotels that housed DragonCon. One night we had a meal with some actors from Australia who were in a sci-fi drama series I'd truly never heard of. My son had hooked up with them. He's half Australian and always seemed to be able to hunt down Aussies wherever he is in the world. This crowd were very friendly and very funny, and I realised then how much more fun the experience of this insane event would be if I was with my fellow dwarfers. I'm not dissing the company of my wonderful offspring. He had a whale of a time and is blessed with very advanced social skills. He became pals with all sorts of people while we were there, and although officially he was there to help his dad, I barely saw him. He found helping other people much more to his liking. At one of these expansive evening meals, I sat next to a very tall woman who looked stunning, even more so when I discovered she was older than me. I eventually learned that this woman was none other than Virginia Hay. She was the woman archery demon dressed in sandblasted white in Mad Max 2, a.k.a. the Road Warrior. She was the woman with the bow and arrow. Legend! I was most impressed. Later that evening, we walked around the convention floors marvelling at all the costumes people had made for the event. These creations were far better than anything I'd ever seen on a film set or in a TV studio. Extraordinary care and skill had gone into making them. We had seen people dressed up as characters from Red Dwarf at conventions in the UK, and while I have no wish to denigrate their efforts, the elaborate costumes people were sporting at DragonCon were staggering. Some on the very outer reaches of what would be considered respectable in normal society. As I queued for coffee the following morning, I noticed a very voluptuous woman sporting an incredibly elaborate and professional body paint job. She was not sporting much else. In fact, she may not have been sporting anything else. She was soon surrounded by hundreds of slightly sweaty young men with camera phones, and she was clearly loving every minute. I never got close enough to see if any cloth-based items were involved in her get-up, but if they were, they were very minimal in the extreme. So unnecessary, and in this particular example, ample innie and outie bits all over the show. What do male humanoids see in it? It was exhausting and wonderful at DragonCon. On the long flight back home, even though we'd been bumped up into business class and my son had a choice of hundreds of movies to watch, he slept through the entire flight. Not long after I got back to the UK, I received the first draft scripts for the new Red Dwarf adventure from Doug. As I read through them, I remember thinking, this is it then. He's going to finish the whole thing off at last. The crew of Red Dwarf arrive back on Earth and discover they have been represented by human actors in a TV series. They then discover that the final script has been written and they're all going to be killed off. It was a brilliant mashup of Blade Runner and Red Dwarf. As usual for Doug, it was incredibly ambitious and very complex, and it even involves shooting scenes on Coronation Street. That's when I knew it would all change. The amount of times we've been told about filming on beaches in Morocco or mountain scenes to be shot in Switzerland, we always ended up in a gravel pit just off the M25. No way were we going to be allowed to record anything on Coronation Street. 6 weeks later, I walked down Coronation Street in full Crichton makeup, possibly one of the most bizarre and genuinely confusing experiences in my life. I found Doug, who looked anxious. "This is unbelievable, Dougie," I said. "I cannot believe I'm here." "Wait till you see Starbug, Bobby," said Doug. I had no idea what he was talking about. Starbug? What, they made a life-sized mock-up of Starbug? Was one of those massive cranes going to lower it onto Coronation Street? I knew we did a scene in a smart car, it said so in the script. But what had Starbug got to do with it? While I was in the costume department getting fitted up, this is the department where on a normal day proper actors get ready to work on Corrie, Danny came running in wearing full cat get-up.
"Guy, this you have got to see."
I followed him out onto the lot, around the corner and onto the life-size set that is the Coronation Street you see in the soap opera. Bouncing down the cobbled street came the most ridiculous vehicle I've ever seen, and after 10 years on Scrap Heap, I've seen a few. It was a smart car that had been dressed in full Starbug outfit.
It just about drove along, its various fairings, wings and add-ons wobbled and scraped on the cobbles alarmingly. When it pulled to a halt, we all walked around it staring in admiration. As we were getting ready to shoot the sequence, where we arrive in Coronation Street to try and find an actor called Craig Charles, who played Lister in the Earth-based series, come on, keep up, it was discovered that somehow, no one seemed to know how, the keys to the little smart car that was the basis of the Starbug-mobile were locked inside the car. Everyone stood around with various theories about how to open it. Helen Norman, longtime Red Dwarf stalwart, and the wonderful woman who runs the office, called the AA. She said, "We've locked our keys in the car. Can you send someone?" The person on the other end of the line said, "Where are you?" Helen told them, "We're on Coronation Street." The person at the AA didn't quite believe her. "What sort of car?" they asked. "Well, it's green," said Helen. "It looks like a spaceship, but I think it's a smart car underneath." In the end, the AA weren't needed, because someone from the props department found a hammer, smashed one of the quarter-like windows, and opened the door, which is why you only ever see the Starbug smart car from one side. We spent a long day on the street, which was bizarre enough for us, but it must have been mind-melting for Craig, who by then had been a regular on the soap for 4 years. Once everything was done in Manchester, we decamped back to Shepperton to start rehearse recording the rest of the episodes. It wasn't until the first morning we were all gathered on the set, all in full costume, that I said, "Blimey, it feels like we've only had a week off." The others had all been saying exactly the same thing. Looking at Craig as Lister was so completely natural. Chris as Rimmer, normal, it's him. Danny as Cat, how else? It was a full 10 years since we'd been in that situation. Me pacing around trying to learn a speech, Chris explaining the beauty of a 1934 straight-six petrol engine to a member of the crew, Danny laughing very loudly and doing a couple of impressive dance moves. It was so similar because at one point Craig came up to me and said, "Hey, Bobby, man, let me have a look at your script a minute. Which scene are we doing, man?" I gave him my script. "It's episode 2, scene 5," I said helpfully. Craig then walked to the nearest bin and threw my script into it. He's been doing that for nearly 23 years, and I still fall for it. Craig would have known all his lines from the moment he picked the script up. I generally just about know mine when we finished recording the scene. For the first time on Red Dwarf, and very possibly the first time on any British comedy show, we were recording the series using a totally new technology, the Red Camera. An American man called Jim Janard, who is quite rich, developed this revolutionary camera, and it is pretty amazing. Jim used to run this little sunglasses company called Oakley that he sold in 2007 for $2 billion. Then he started making the Red camera. Not on his own, I'm sure. I think he hired a couple of clever people to help him. The Red is known as a 4K camera. It's all very technical and complicated, but essentially it was one of the first cameras where the resulting video footage was on a par with 35mm film stock. Basically, you just get more picture in your picture. What comes out of this little box of tricks is a picture so humongously enormous it baffles the eye. When we watch HD telly at home, well, frankly, in comparison to what the Red produces, it's all a bit embarrassing. A lot of films we now see at the cinema are not shot on film at all. Oh no, it's all gone digital, darling. When we saw the playback of shots we'd done on a truly enormous screen, the image quality was breathtaking. If there was a shot of myself and Danny standing next to each other, the editor could expand the picture so it's just a shot of Danny, basically turning a two-shot into a single. And there was no discernible lowering of quality. This clearly gave Doug and the editor a lot more freedom when they cut the shows together. The only problem with this newfangled technology is that it is pushing the limits of the computers and hard drives that have to process the video to the very bleeding edge of the possibility envelope. However, on the plus side, where a normal broadcast camera can cost anything up to £80,000, the Red camera is about £10,000. But that's just a little box with wires coming out of it. If you actually want to shoot something with it, you have to fit a lens, £60,000, and a huge array of hard drives and computers, £25,000, to store the immense amounts of data the cameras spew out every second. This was so different to the broadcast videotapes everyone was used to working with.
There was much tension every day as the camera crew backed up the vast files we produced, hundreds of hard drives spinning away into the night. I don't know how much space we used up shooting back to Earth. I would guess loads of USB key fobs, like 10 truckloads. Imagine, if you will, now indulge me here for a moment, imagine me in a dressing gown, a rubber head and a pair of Crocs, standing in the studio next to the red camera, explaining this fascinating technology to Craig. "Oh, well, look at that, Craigie. It's the red camera. This is the first one I've seen in the wild," I said, staring at the complex box festooned with wires, lenses and backup drives. "It's not red, it's black," said Craig. "No, it's called the red camera, Craigie. That's like the name of it. Bit of a stupid name if it's black. But it's a revolutionary piece of tech. It's cutting edge. You need to get out more, Bobby." "You see, it records in 4K, I said with enormous enthusiasm. "And it doesn't record to tape. Tape just can't cope with the data load. It records direct to hard disks. Massive spinning platters of bulk data storage. The picture is just huge. The file sizes are massive." "Bobby, steady, man," said Craig. "Remember who you're talking to. Don't confuse me with someone who is in the least bit interested in anything you've ever said." "Sorry, Craig, I forgot," I said. Then Craig borrowed my script again, took it outside, and set fire to it so he could light his cigarette from it. Then there was the squid. Every now and then, when we've made an episode of Red Dwarf, we engage in a scene that requires a certain amount of physical risk. It's all conducted in a controlled environment, and every safety precaution is taken. Like with the squid. In the story of Red Dwarf Back to Earth, the crew discover the massive water tanks were running low, and then find out that a giant squid has made its home in the tanks. How did it get there? Possibly, just possibly, Cat had put a little fishy in there at some time, and due to general sci-fi smeg, it had grown into a multi-tentacled, psychopathic leviathan. As we all know on the Small Rouge One, smeg happens. So Rimmer lowers Cat, Crichton and Lister down into the storage tank in a submersible to try and catch the beast, and it attacks the submersible, sending some of its giant tentacles inside. That's what it said in the script. Easy peasy. So we all get in the small submersible set that had been built up on a raised platform. This allowed the special effects chaps to get underneath and control the massive, heavy, thick, solid, tentacly things made of thick, heavy, solid, rubbery stuff. Easy peasy. All we then had to do was wrestle with the tentacles in a very confined space with some splashy water. The tentacles looked very convincing. They looked quite dangerous. Little fear acting required. They scared the bejesus out of me as they thrashed around in the tiny space we were in. Craig and I took a right battering. It's fine for him. He's tough. He does all his own stunts. I'm a wet liberal pacifist. That essentially is a politically correct term for an out-and-out limp-wristed coward. I slammed around in that stoutly built box with very little physical restraint as the out-of-control tentacles thrashed about in chaos. It seemed to go on for hours. A number of different camera angles and only one camera meant we needed to perform the battle again and again. I'm making it sound less fun than it was. Actually, it was brilliant. But we did get quite badly bashed about. I smashed part of the set with my head. It's amazing how little protection a rubber head gives you. Craig got 7 bells knocked out of him, but then he does that fighty stuff with gusto and never complained. Danny's hair got very slightly messed up, and that was a tragedy. We then started working with Sophie Winkleman, who, apart from being just ever so slightly gorgeous, is frighteningly clever and quite posh. The cast of Red Dwarf don't really do poshness. We don't quite know how to handle it. But to give Sophie her due, she didn't seem to hold it against us. As former Red Dwarf science officer Katerina Bartakovsky, she was meant to be clipped, efficient and slightly frightening, which she did with panache. I'd seen some of the very funny sketches Sophie wrote for the Harry Enfield and Paul Whitehouse show, the sketches where Harry plays a louche trustafarian who runs a shop in Notting Hill that sells tiny cushions for £450. Women come into the chintzy emporium called I Saw You Coming with their husband's credit card and fall for every half-baked sales technique the poshly pouting Harry throws at them. When they can't remember their husband's credit card pin, Harry obliges, assuring them that he does. Top stuff, and if you've ever walked around the posher parts of Notting Hill in West London, near where the Camerons live, it's frighteningly accurate.
While we were working with Sophie, we heard she was getting married. How lovely. I think we all pictured a nice wedding ceremony in some outer London suburb, maybe even a Rolls-Royce her dad hired for the day. In fact, she was due to marry Lord Frederick Windsor at Hampton Court Palace. I think the fleet of Rolls-Royces came from Buckingham Palace, and I have to say, we weren't overly shocked when none of us received an invite. The final scenes were shot in the studio where we met our creator, brilliantly played by Richard O'Callaghan. He's effectively playing Doug, the creator of Red Dwarf, the TV series, based on the lives and adventures of the Red Dwarf crew. Come on, keep up. The creator had written the last episode of Red Dwarf, the episode where we all die. The chase sequence through the nighttime market was an amazing experience. Everyone who could be corralled into action gathered in the studio that night. A few extras, friends of friends, anyone hanging about, was dressed by the ever-resourceful Howard Burden. If you'd seen the set in daylight, it would have looked like a bunch of students in cloaks with weird hats standing next to some tables. But at night, it looked like a futuristic Blade Runner marketplace. We had to run out of a building and through the market being chased by the creator, who was determined to kill us. On the second take, some plastic bins filled with paper were placed in our way. My job was to kick one out of the way to add a bit of drama to the chase. When I was a kid, I could walk up to a stationary football on the playing fields with the determined intention of kicking it. I would invariably miss. I am utterly useless at sport. However, on the night shoot, I suddenly gained incredible skill in the kicking arena. I kicked the bin with enormous force, and it flew away. As I continued to run, following Craig through the parting crowds, we heard a loud bang. Actually, more of an explosion. I thought it was part of the scene, a special effect. It sounded very realistic, and I was really impressed. Once we had passed the camera and stopped, we discovered that the bin I had kicked with such skill had hit a big light stand, sending it toppling to the ground. On impact, the bulb exploded, casting the whole set in darkness, meaning we had to shoot the whole sequence again. If you accidentally knock over a lamp at home, it might cost a couple of quid. Your mum gets cross and you have to get out the dustpan and brush. But if you knock over a massive film light, well, let's just say there may have been a substantial insurance claim. The finale of this scene was a recreation of the replicant death scene from Blade Runner, when Harrison Ford shoots the replicant woman in the back and she crashes through panes of glass in slow-mo. It's okay, it's not meant to be an actual woman, it's a replicant, so it's okay for the hero, Harrison, to shoot her in the back. He doesn't enjoy it, he's all conflicted and troubled, which apparently, so many ladies have informed me, makes him even more sexy. Ultra-violent, but troubled, that's the way to attract ladies, chaps. Hey-ho. For many hours, the special effects team hung huge sheets of sugar glass into a makeshift frame. There was going to be no rehearsal for this shot. It was a one-take wonder. Craig's family arrived on the set, and we were getting ready to shoot the sequence. There was much jollity, and everyone was excited to see the crashing death sequence. The special effects crew explained what was going to happen, how we needed to keep going as we crashed through the sheets of sugar glass and dived onto the crash mat at the other side. None of us knew if they would break easily. We were used to sugar glass bottles from the past. When you bust one over your head, although it shatters and won't cut you, they are quite hard, and they can, as we discovered, hurt. Massive sheets of the stuff were a complete unknown, and we didn't have enough spare sheets to have a practice run. Everybody was under strict instructions to move carefully. The area of the studio where the sugar glass was hanging was cordoned off. You couldn't even breathe heavily on this stuff. It was that delicate. When everything was ready, Doug called action, and we just ran. I was right next to Craig, who was head-butting his way through the sheets. I was, of course, slightly chicken, and used my protected Crichton arm to break the glass. It was tougher than we expected, and very dramatic, shattering in clouds of shards as we barged through. One by one, we collapsed on the fake snow-covered crash mat and lay very still. There was silence. We were waiting for Doug to shout cut. There was a long pause. I started to worry that the whole thing had gone wrong or it looked rubbish, but suddenly I heard Doug shout, cut! And then he said, fantastic! Which, believe me, is unusual for Doug. We all gathered around a massive monitor screen a few moments later and watched the sequence in super slow motion.
I was almost of a mind to explain to Craig that the Red camera was capable of shooting at 70 frames a second, allowing this sort of incredibly smooth slow-mo action, but I thought better of it. The sequence did look amazing, although as always I was disappointed that I hadn't charged through the plate glass using my big rubber head as a battering ram. When the final shot was in the can, how dated is that term now, when the final shot was backed up onto a remote server, the makeup was stripped off, the set started to be dismantled and the weary actors wandered off, it was anyone's guess as to how the show was going to be received. It certainly got a lot of attention from the press, and a few weeks later we all gathered at the offices of UKTV in the centre of London to do a load of interviews. As Chris, Danny and I walked up the street towards the office, we noticed a lot of paparazzi hanging around the street outside. Oh yes, it's celebrity time. Loads of attention from the tabloid press. Welcome to the modern world. However, we soon learned they weren't hanging around to see us. They were hanging around a hotel next door. A hotel where the BBC was holding a press conference for a new series of Doctor Who. Hey-ho, not a problem. Red Dwarf exists in a universe of its own. Unusually for us, there was a big press launch where the shows were first seen by a lot of people in a posh preview theatre in London. Again, it was just Chris, Danny and I from the cast as Craig was filming Coronation Street and couldn't make it. It was a great shame and we all missed him. But watching the finished shows, when for a large proportion of the time we had no idea what they would look like, was quite a revelation. All we'd seen for many of the sequences were huge green screens, which, we were told, would be finished to look like we were in a massive Red Dwarf storage area. When we saw it, there we were, standing in a massive Red Dwarf storage area. It was seamless, it looked amazing. Shots of Craig walking along a corridor looked totally convincing, even though he'd actually been walking along a raised walkway with nothing around him but vast expanses of green cloth. A big surprise for all of us was seeing the scene where Lister drives off in the smart car Starbug with Kachansky. Only Craig and Chloe were present on that day, so we hadn't seen any of that sequence. The shows were broadcast in the UK over Easter of 2009. The audience figures, which we heard a few days later, were nothing short of extraordinary. Over 4 million people tuned in to see the first episode. On Dave. I mean, I don't want to show off too much. I know it's not that important in the grand scheme of things, but 4 million? Blimey. Okay, in the UK, if 4 million people watched, that meant that around 56 million people didn't watch. But still, come on, the small Rouge one rocks. As for critical acclaim, there's no point trying to avoid the fact that some people clearly didn't like the way it looked. There were many complaints about the shows containing too much CGI, computer-generated imagery. Many people say they preferred the wobbly sets and the model shots we'd used in the early series. That said, though, I think most people enjoyed it. I've met many people who loved it and were thrilled to see the show back on the small screen. What they, and indeed we, didn't know at the time, was this was just the start. The small Rouge one was definitely coming back.
Chapter 6. I felt my mouth scream out a swear word involuntarily. I really didn't want to swear, but I'd lost all self-control. The reason behind the swearing was essentially down to my right inner ear. I only discovered this after the event, but sometimes, apparently, your inner ear gets a bit rusty as the years pass, and this can lead to feelings of dizziness and disorientation. I suppose, to be fair to my trusty old right inner ear, there were some rather violent inputs which could cause such disturbances. I was in the middle of recording a new series of How Do They Do It for Channel 5, once again a dream job for me. I went all over the place seeing how things were made, and if those things happened to be diggers, or high explosives, or absurdly fast cars, or in the case of the swearing, a Red Bull aerobatic aircraft, I'd have a go in them. I met the pilot of the very small Red Bull plane on a very small airfield on the Isle of Wight. He was a charming man and a very experienced pilot from Zimbabwe. He was a white Zimbabwean, and he had that very particular, clipped, slightly Afrikaans accent. He was about the same age as me, and he had entered many aerobatic competitions and had a long and faultless career as a pilot. Now, I'm not totally stupid. I'd seen what the Red Bull guys do in their tiny and very powerful planes, but the director assured me that wasn't their intention. They just wanted some footage of me inside the plane as it flew. The pilot would explain how the whole thing worked as we pootled along. When I climbed into the incredibly small cockpit decked out with little cameras like I use on carpool, the pilot checked my seatbelt and told me not to touch the controls that were right in front of me. I was sitting in the front seat. He was sitting right behind me, and I mean right behind. That's how small this plane was. Then the director asked me not to swear. I looked at him slightly confused. How do they do it? It was an early evening show, popular with lads and dads, as the TV executives described it. I'd never come close to swearing on camera. Why did I need to be told now? We took off. The acceleration was breathtaking. How can a spinny propeller thing pull you along that fast? Incredible. We flew level with the ground for a while. I say level, I could tell we were level because we were no more than 10 feet off the ground. Then the pilot asked,
"Are you okay, Robert?"
over the headphones, his thick Zimbabwean accent clear above the noisy engine. I said,
"Yeah, it's brilliant!"
which it was. You see, I love flying. I've been in two-seater microlights, hedgehopping. I've flown sideways in helicopters just above the ground in the Mojave Desert. I've been in sailplanes above Sydney Harbour in Australia. All those experiences were wonderful and memorable. I didn't know I was about to experience something rather more extreme. We went from flying straight and level with the ground to flying vertically upwards in less than a scream. The most violent movement my body has ever experienced. I can't remember much about it as I immediately blacked out. When I came to, I couldn't see. Well, I could see red. Nothing else, just red. A bit weird. I was also screaming very rude words in a torrent of total terror. Then my stomach hit the roof of my mouth as we leveled out, and I discovered another thing to my cost. I don't get flight sick. Apparently that stomach hitting roof of mouth thing makes most people vomit instantly. Not me, damn it.
"Do you feel sick?"
asked the pilot. I was rapidly going off this guy.
"No!"
I said.
"Bah!"
Before I could say anything else, the sky went profoundly swirly, and then a load of green field-looking things went very swirly too. We were spinning and diving towards the Isle of Wight, and I was screaming out more uncontrollable swear words. We did quite a lot more wibbly-wobbly flying, and that's when we discovered the inner ear thing. If the pilot banked hard to the left, I was as happy as Larry, looking down at the green fields far below. He did many hard, tight turns to the left. No problem for me. If he tipped a little bit to the right, I started effing and jeffing like it was going out of fashion. Apparently, my right inner ear just sent me into a head spin. It doesn't really make sense now, but it all seemed perfectly plausible at the time. So here's a tip. If you are ever unlucky enough to find yourself in the cockpit of a Red Bull aerobatic plane and the pilot asks you if you feel sick, scream "Yes!" as loud as you can and then tell him you're going to turn your head and be sick all over him. That will make him fly steady. When we did eventually land and I managed to clamber out of the tiny cockpit, I hugged the pilot long enough to make him uncomfortable with the whole man-on-man thing. I was so grateful to be alive and standing on the ground, I couldn't stop. I was very emotional. When the director looked at the footage a few days later, he was in despair. There wasn't anything but swear words. Editors will sometimes apply a sound-killing bleep over the offensive word. In this instance, they had to beep the whole thing and pixelate my mouth because it was very easy to lip-read what I was saying. So that's one of the many things I did between Back to Earth and Red Dwarf 10. I could tell you about the lifeboat in Cornwall, that was fun, or the military assault craft in the Baltic when I spent a week with the Royal Marines on board HMS Bulwark, or I could mention the launch and incredible success of Carpool, my online sort of chat show but not series on the internet. If you haven't seen it, dig it out on YouTube or iTunes. Most of the dwarfers are on there. But this is a story about the small rouge one and the adventures of a bunch of now late middle-aged space bums. Once again, when we were told about the new series, the description ended with the pointed comment, pointed as it was in my direction by Doug, "Bobby, don't say anything on Twitter." I didn't say a word, not one tweet, even though I was constantly being asked if there was going to be a new series. My tweet stream was crystal clear, not a trace of smeg in the flow. I assume we had all been told the same thing. Do not announce anything until it's officially announced by UK TV and Dave. Craig was working on Coronation Street. I'd driven him to work in an episode of Carpool, and they actually let him in through the gates, so I knew he really did work there. During the period between us being told the cold hard facts of the new series and the announcement date, Craig was interviewed on a radio show in Manchester.
"So, Craig, lots of rumours about the new series of Red Dwarf. Have you got anything you can tell us?"
says the jocular morning show host. "No way, man. I'm not allowed to say anything about the new series of Red Dwarf I'm making. I got in trouble last time. I am keeping quiet, la." My tweet stream went ballistic. Hey-ho. So, in December of 2011, we all gathered in a conference room at the side of K Stage in Shepperton Studios. Outside, there was a lot of commotion, a lot of horses, and a lot of Cossacks. We discovered this was because the final scenes of the movie Anna Karenina, starring Keira Knightley, were being filmed on the backlot. Okay, a quick pointless actor's anecdote, and then I really will get down to Red Dwarf 10. So, I visit my agent's office about twice a year. I'm on the phone to them all the time. Emails fly about like gnats around your privates, but I don't often actually go into the actual office. My wonderful agent Maureen is part of a large management group called United Agents, and they represent really properly famous and actually talented actors, including Keira Knightley. One time when I dropped in for a meeting with Maureen, I walked past an office belonging to another agent. I wasn't gawping or perving about to see who was in, honestly. I stared because something unusual caught my eye. There, sitting on a chair in a glass-partitioned office with her back to me, was a woman with a quite inconceivably long neck. I only ever saw the back of her head, so when I saw Maureen further down the corridor, I gestured in big, pathetic, actory mime talk, pointing very obviously and silently saying, "Is that Keira Knightley?" I was quickly ushered into her office and told to behave. It was Keira Knightley, by the way, but I wasn't allowed to go and stare. So then, first day on Red Dwarf 10, and there's a load of horses and men dressed as Cossacks and loads of people in puffer jackets carrying clipboards, and in amongst this throng, trotting away from me on a beautiful horse, is a woman with an inconceivably long neck. It was Keira Knightley. Twice now, I've seen the back of her head. I've never seen her face. Not that I'm obsessed, I'm not stalking her or anything. I've just been quite close to her twice and never seen her. In a way, it's a metaphor for my entire life. I've been close to stardom, fame, glamour, an exclusive lifestyle, immense wealth and contact with the rich and powerful. But this life has always had its back to me and is moving away fast on a massive white horse. Now that, ladies and gentlemen, is a classic actor's anecdote. Long, pointless, over-dramatised, and we learn absolutely nothing from the telling of it. So, moving on. K Stage in Shepperton, inside the conference room, day one. "Okay, listen up, people," said Jim Imber, the first assistant director, a man who exuded confidence in the ability to get the job done. "We're going to read through the scripts now. Afterwards, we'll have a meeting to discuss what we need to do. Everyone ready?" I was as ready as I'd ever be, which is to say, woefully unprepared. There were a lot of people present, some we know well, some we'd never met before. I'd only been sent three scripts before the first read-through, and I'd read them avidly. But now, sitting in this room with all these people, I returned to my default setting for such experiences, that of not having a clue what was happening or what was expected of me. I love it when I receive Red Dwarf scripts through the post, as I had done a few days before the read-through. They plop through the letterbox, and everything else has to wait. The chickens go hungry, the dog is busting for a wee and hassling me, but I'm reading scripts and they all have to wait. They were funny, punchy, classic Red Dwarf. I love them. But then I'm just a secret fanboy covered in rubber. What would I know? As usual, the only thing that filled me with dread was the long Crichton speeches. And there, in the second script I read, was the mother of speeches. It was a classic chunk of Crichton exposition, a wonderfully verbose and intricate explanation of the Erroneous Reasoning Research Academy, or ERRA for short. Days later, I carried these scripts as I walked the dog through the autumn mist-covered Cotswolds. I tried to remember the first three lines. I repeated them over and over again, glancing at the script as I walked. I got up to the first line, and then I went totally blank. Memory's not improved then, I said to myself. I have become very adept at either writing a short paragraph or introducing something, or simply making it up on the spot and delivering it to camera. I must have done it thousands of times on shows like Scrap Heap and How Do They Do It. I did it while I was driving on Carpool. I've done hundreds this year for the Fully Charged series. I'm a bit like a goldfish. I have a really good, really efficient, ultra-short-term memory. If it's longer than 5 seconds from the moment I drop the piece of paper to the moment the director says action, I have serious problems. I carried on walking. The dog took no notice of my struggle. She was too busy sniffing for rabbits. She's quite old, slightly deaf and a bit blind. Rabbits cavort right in front of her. They point and laugh their little rabbit laughs. They hop about with impunity, confident that they are in no danger. I didn't notice them either. I was engrossed in deep space. I knew the coming 10 weeks were going to be a challenge. Not only were the scripts littered with killer Crichton speeches, but we were recording this series in front of an audience. That takes the whole rubber-covered experience into a brand new hall of terror. Well, it does for me anyway. If it's just the cast and crew in a closed set, me fluffing my lines just requires an apology and some mild jocular teasing from my fellow performers. But if I fluff a line in front of an audience, the audience tends to notice. Not only that, they love it when we smeg up. They are almost willing us to fail. The smeg-ups and smeg-outs have been hugely popular, and we've produced bucket loads of them over the years. I have, as some of you may know, been a prime contributor to this humiliating but popular art form. So, after 14 years of not performing covered in rubber in front of an enthusiastic audience, I knew I had to raise my game. The other thing I had to do was lose my hair. I haven't got that much left anyway, but I've learned the advantage of shaving it off. Back in the 1980s, when I started working on Red Dwarf, I still had a proper head of hair, like thick and dark. 24 years of Red Dwarf, children, marriage, Scrap Heap challenge, and general domestic and financial stress has cruelly manifested itself in my once luscious locks. I now have a paltry grey covering that resembles a threadbare 1950s bath mat. I sat down in the kitchen the night before I set off for Shepperton and Rubber Glory and handed my daughter the hair clippers. I don't think I've ever had so much fun making you look stupid, she said as she cut a swathe right across the top of my slowly balding head. This is so weird, she added. 20 minutes later, with the remnants of a 1950s bath mat on the floor around my feet, I look like the dome-headed old fool I really am. Oh my God, I said as my daughter held a mirror in front of me. That is measurably tragic. I went through a box of old clothes my son had once left lying on the floor. It's one of the joys of parenthood. I grunt around the house, picking up and sorting discarded clothes and shoving them in boxes, then return the box to the room of the original owner with tiresome pleading for something resembling order and tidiness. I've never been able to fully explain to my wonderful son what function a chest of drawers could serve in his life. I know he's never used one. He's a free spirit, a creative soul, and a young man who is able to express himself in the world. For him, the floor is the perfect storage area for anything and everything. Inside the box, among the hoodies and tattered jeans, was an old woolen ski hat. I pulled it on and set off for the dwarf. The first episode we recorded was Trojan, although when we made the episode, it was titled Slow Rescue. As we were rehearsing and blocking out the scenes we had to record, we became increasingly aware of the soon-to-be-arriving audience. When I'd first walked around the set, there were no audience seats in place. But when we arrived for the first full day's rehearsals, the seating banks were being fitted. A massive truck was parked outside the cargo doors, and a forklift truck was trundling in and out, carting piles of lightweight aluminium flooring ready to be fitted with fold-down seats. How did I know so much about this temporary mass seating system used to such effect at the London 2012 Olympics? Because I'd done a voiceover about it for a Discovery series called How Stuff's Made. You see, I'm a mine of highly useful technical information. It wasn't as if we didn't know we were going to record in front of an audience. Of course we did. But there is a huge difference between saying, "Oh, darling, we have to have a live audience," when you're in a meeting, and actually recording the show with one watching. I was becoming increasingly anxious about the whole thing. So we rehearse and josh about, and Craig sets fire to my script, and we start to get some of the scenes off the page. That's actors speak for being in a mentally confident position of knowing your lines. I say we. I mean, of course, Chris and Craig. They were already able to run a scene without gripping onto their script. Danny was close to being in that position, while I was still wandering around running my lines again and again, while hoping no one will notice and remain under the illusion that I am some kind of actor. All too soon for me, it was time to get ready for the first audience recording. The seats were in, the lights were up, the cameras were ready. We did a long camera rehearsal in costume, but not in makeup. This is so the lighting cameraman can adjust everything and get some idea of what we'll look like on the night. Of course, the fact that my daughter had given me a shaved head meant there wasn't such a big jump from the bald-headed old bloke with the metal suit on to the true glory that is Crichton 2X4B523P. At the last minute, I head into the makeup department. Danny soon joined me for his wig fitting, followed by Chris and Craig for their slap-on H, hair enhancements, and a bit of helpful powder. Okay, quite a lot more helpful powder than either of them used back in 1989. We run lines again and again, but this is mixed in with general badinage and reflection on past Red Dwarf glories and behind-the-scenes hilarity. Most of this is reenacted by Danny, who jumps around recreating certain well-worn stories from our past, me watching him in the mirror while trying to keep my rubber head motionless. Even though I've heard these stories countless times, I am still prone to bursting out laughing. This doesn't make the process of attaching the Crichton mask any easier, as you can imagine. For the previous Lord knows how many series, Andrea Finch has done Crichton's makeup. On series 10, she was replaced by a very capable and extremely pregnant young woman called Liz Hart. It made the experience of having the makeup applied all the more intimate. I would try and sit in positions where my elbows didn't make jabbing contact with Liz's quite magnificent mummy bulge. No matter how much noise, laughter and obscenity were flying around the makeup room, Liz just calmly carried on working. As usual with anyone stuck in a makeup chair for hours, the makeup artist and her victim get to know about each other in some detail. Liz was very skilled, very patient, and had a few surprises for me when she told me her life story. I won't reveal anything here. She's writing about that herself, and I hope to read her book one day. Believe me, it'll make 50 Shades of Grey look like a toddler's nursery rhyme collection. Next, it was down a flight of stairs to the costume department. I was fitted up in full Crichton by the charming Caterina Capalazzi, Howard Burden's new assistant. She learned to be very patient with us too. As you can imagine with a name like that, both Mr. Barry and myself had to keep repeating her name with as strong an Italian accent as we could manage, which, considering our prodigious vocal talents, was both technically accurate and very loud. Caterina Capalazzi! I should point out that Caterina was born in England and doesn't have the vaguest trace of an Italian accent. But why let mere facts stop you expressing yourself? When everyone was ready, we heard from Helen Norman that the seating banks were chock full and Doug was about to go in and make an announcement. It's important to state that the only reason we recorded the show in front of an audience was because Craig, Chris, Danny, Doug and I insisted on it. It makes everything much harder and more expensive. It puts enormous pressure on the camera and sound crew. It's as if you are used to cooking over a pile of smouldering sticks and suddenly you're using a nuclear-powered pressure cooker. Everything is condensed and faster. The pressure to get the show done in under 2 hours is enormous. We made our way through the dark tangle of wires and props at the back of the set and waited nervously. I have since confirmed with my fellow dwarfers that we were all really nervous that night. We hadn't performed in Red Dwarf in front of an audience for 14 years. It was a leap of faith. Surely they would enjoy it. Surely they would laugh like they used to. That's what we hoped, but there was no way of knowing. When Doug appeared at the front of the set, the noise was incredible. He made a short speech pleading with the audience not to post spoilers on Twitter and Facebook. He explained about the battle we'd been through to get a live audience, and if the web was flooded with spoilers, we'd never convince broadcasters to let us do it again. I'm very pleased to report that all the wonderful audiences who attended the recordings were incredibly honourable and posted not a smeg stain of spoilerdom. Our indefatigable warm-up artist, Ray Peacock, introduced us one by one in alphabetical order, which meant I went on last. I heard the rip-roaring cheer as Rimmer marched out into the light, looking, as Lister had once commented, like he was invading Poland. I assume he performed the Rimmer salute to welcome the hordes, and they went ape. He was followed by a scruffy but lovable Lister, another deafening roar of greeting. Next, Mr. Cat emerged, resplendent in a glittering suit and Cuban-heeled boots. He did a few ridiculously energetic cat dance moves, not bad for a bloke over 50, and of course, this was greeted with screams, yelps, cheers and whistles. Finally, old Critters hobbled toward the waiting crowd, and I knew at once that these four lovable characters had been much missed. But then we had to record the actual show. The first scene we recorded that night took place in the drive room, when Cat and Lister discussed the weird facts Lister had learned from a book he'd found that 3 million years earlier had belonged to Peterson. It was all about the moose causing road accidents in Sweden in the 1970s. As usual, we had to shoot the scene a couple of times to get all the shots recorded, standard practice. Next was the scene in the sleeping quarters, Rimmer swatting for his officer's exam. He wasn't doing well, particularly on the lateral thinking questions. The one about the moose causing accidents had him stumped. We ran through the scene. The audience loved it. They laughed and clapped. It was fast-paced, with multiple entrances and exits, and we didn't trip over. I remembered my lines, Danny remembered his, Chris was brilliant, Craig was fantastic, and to top the whole thing off, we got it in one take. This is not usual. This was a fluke. Doing a whole scene in one take with no pickups means everything worked. The actors, the cameras, the sound, the lights, the moves, the lines, the shots. A huge list of tasks, any one of which could have gone a bit wibbly-wobbly. When we gathered together to do the next scene, we knew, finally, the old boys from the Dwarf were back. It was such a good start that we approached the next scene in high spirits, but the next scene, as they say in America, was a doozy. Not so much because of the story or the scripts, the costumes, makeup, wigs, hair weaves and teeth extensions, that was all regular stuff. This one was a killer because of the set. The Quantum Twister is a supremely advanced space core ship we stumble across, abandoned in deep space. Rimmer is, of course, most impressed. It's the pride of the Space Corps, manned by heroic officers who are all ripped and pipped and ready to defend our way of life. The set was fantastic. It looked great. The captain's chair on its special plinth with hundreds of special buttons was a dream for Rimmer. However, it was a bit of a nightmare for the camera crew and Doug. It's all about getting the angles, getting the shots of each of us, and making it look like we're all in the same space. There was just something about the layout that made this incredibly hard. We spent literally hours rehearsing on the set, Danny and I at our front consoles, Craig sitting to one side on the phone waiting for his call to be put through, Chris obviously lording it in his special big captain's chair. It's where Chris always should be. He needs one of those chairs in his house. During camera rehearsals, we had to deliver our lines, then step back to allow the camera to take our place, then move back into position for the next line. The scene was also quite long, and the set was at the far end of the studio, not directly in front of the audience. This meant getting audience feedback, our bread and butter when we're recording, was slightly delayed and distant. However, the performance of the wonderful Mark Dexter as Rimmer's brother Howard was a treat to behold. That young man is a natural. Well, we did it, we got it in the can, the audience were fantastic, and they clearly enjoyed it. It was such a relief to get the first episode done, even though we knew there were pickups, scenes we didn't have time to record when the audience were present. They clearly understood the story, they loved the jokes, laughed in the right places, it was brilliant. After 14 years off, after countless false starts and heartbreaking letdowns, it really did feel like the show was back. However, no sooner had the dust settled on the first episode, we were deep into rehearsals on the second, Fathers and Sons. At the read-through, we first met Rebecca Blackstone, who played the newly rebooted ship's computer, Pre. She's not only a rather beautiful young lady, but also endowed with prodigious piles of talent. She had an incredible range of voices, and as you may remember, an uncanny ability to keep her eyes open. I'm sure an avid viewer might be able to catch her blinking as she tells the crew how doomed they are, but I never saw her so much as flicker. We were shooting this episode in the weeks before Christmas. It was mercifully cold, which may sound a bit odd, but when we did the long day's pre-shoot, that meant I was in the Crichton costume from 7 in the morning till around 7 at night. As usual in this sorry tale, I have no wish to go into detail, but let's just say it gets a little moist and clammy under the pristine Crichton exterior. Knowing it was bloody freezing outside meant I could go out of the studio for the odd break and cool down, and it actually made a difference. I could stand outside the studio, balance my lukewarm milky tea on a car bonnet, rest my script next to it, and try to actually learn my lines. A new aspect of my experience in rubber soon came to the fore. Due to far too many hours in front of crude early computer screens, my once perfect 20/20 vision has gone down the pan. I need my specs, or all I can see is the odd blob of colour and light. I certainly can't read a script without my glasses. I have a tatty collection of old specs, including a pair that have bendy side bits. I can expand them and ease them over Crichton's ears, and that allows me to see the print on the page. It must look very weird, but the rest of the cast and crew got used to it very quickly. So I'm outside, steam escaping from my neck hole, script on the bonnet of a car, glasses on, and a plastic cup of lukewarm milky tea with a straw in it. Ooh, the glamour! The lovely members of the crew who supplied my tea around the clock, I told them I was happy to make my own, but they got there too quickly. Soon learned that I wanted my tea vaguely warm, bit of milk, bit of sugar, virtually undrinkable in normal life. I said, just make a shit cup of tea, that'll be perfect. From then on it became known as Robert's Shit Tea. Rhys, a wonderful young chap who looked after us very well, would approach with a tray. Coffee for you, Chris, and a cup of shit tea for Robert. Thanks muchly. Because I drink the tea through a straw to stop it getting on Crichton's rubber lips, it can't be too hot. I can't feel my lips, so there's no warning as to how hot the tea is. If you want to try this experiment, please go ahead, but it really does hurt. Get a cup of steaming hot tea and shove a drinking straw into it. Then put the straw in your mouth and suck. Now, you may need hospital treatment for mouth blisters, so I advise not trying it and don't try and sue me. Just believe me, shit tea is the stuff you need. One of the big problems we had during the shooting of Fathers and Sons was Craig. He is nothing if not highly professional. I know he has a reputation for being a bit of a lad. True, a bottle of rosé doesn't last long when Craig's in the room. A vindaloo curry that could peel paint is seen as a light, zesty snack by this man of iron, but he's always at work on time and he always knows his lines. However, during the rehearsals, it was very clear he was seriously under the weather. He had proper, full-on man flu. He had actual doctors look at him and shake their heads. So Craig spent 2 days in bed and we did what we could without him, which, if you remember the episode, wasn't a great deal. This episode really revolved around him and his issues with fatherhood from the point of view of both father and son. Well, Lister is his own dad, but you all know that. It's all to do with, as Lister so rightly explained, time-travelly sci-fi paradoxy smeg. Chris and I recorded the scene where Pre refits the corridor on B-deck and everything goes wrong. Explosions, sparks and a terrible mess. We gather on the set and run through the scene for the cameras and special effects team. The whole place had been wired with small charges, smoke machines, sparky wiring and bits dropping off the ceiling. We were used to this kind of thing. We are battle-hardened space bums. A few explosions don't worry us. We start the scene and, of course, it all went wrong. It has to. It wouldn't be Red Dwarf if it didn't go wrong. As the team got stuck into refitting the charges and wiring everything up again, I realised that I've finally matured a tiny bit. For once, it wasn't my fault that it all went wrong, and there's nothing I can personally do to make it all go right. All I can do is get out of the way and let the professionals take over. In my early days on Red Dwarf, I would worry and feel guilty about everything. Even if it wasn't my fault, I'd somehow work out that really it was. Somewhere along the line, my incompetence had let everybody down. Second time around, and the scene all went swimmingly. All the explosions exploded, the lights flashed, and all the sparks went fzzz. Chris and I had to walk to a blank screen that would, we were reassured, eventually show the face of Pre. Rebecca was sitting at the side of the set, shouting out her lines so we could react off them. It all got a bit noisy with explosions, wind machines, smoke machines, and general chaos. Pre explained to us that she had carried out the essential repair work in exactly the manner it would have been done if we had done it ourselves, i.e. utterly rubbish. Craig recovered from his mega man flu and returned to the studio looking suitably rough for his role as his own father. He recorded the sequences as his dad, who was berating his son David while getting drunk. His drunk acting is unsurpassed. No one without deep personal experience of such states could hope to achieve such a breathtaking and yet underplayed and subtle portrayal of inebriation. All Craig was actually drinking was apple juice. He got through many cartons. "It's weird, isn't it?" Craig said to me as he wiped his makeup off after the recording. "I've drunk loads of this stuff and I'm not pissed. Something tells me it's not part of me regular diet, la." 2 days before Christmas, we got ready for the audience again. There was a bit of a party atmosphere going on as the crowds arrived. Once again, we were introduced and started recording episode 2. The show went really well. The scenes with Pre were brilliant. The story held together well, and at the end of a long night, another episode was in the can. Well, most of it. There were still crucial scenes that needed recording. Complex, critical, crucial scenes. But we do them later, in the pickup week. It was just the start. We had plenty of time. That was the general consensus. I spent a quiet Christmas day with my family. It was lovely. I was lovely. The missus was lovely. And the children were lovely. Even the dog made an effort. The family snaps taken on the day make us look like a normal, happy, well-functioning family unit, which alone is something of an achievement. The only tragic thing about the family pictures is the totally bald old bloke holding up a small glass of red wine. "Look at that massive loser," was the comment my lovely 18-year-old son Louis said later when he saw the pictures. Charming. After 2 weeks off, I was back to the studio for the long run. 4 episodes to record, plus all the pickups. Oh yeah, the pickups. They loomed over us, an ever-growing list of little scenes and close-ups, reaction shots and special effects sequences that we would do in the pickup week. Episode 3 was a real highlight. It includes the only scene we shot outside the studio. In the past, we would often spend a week, sometimes 2, shooting special exterior scenes before the studio recordings in front of the audience. In Red Dwarf 10, this was not to be. Budget restrictions prohibited dragging the entire team to a gravel pit in Kent or a sewage works on the Isle of Dogs. The only exterior sequence was when the Red Dwarf crew had completed building the flat-pack Swedish self-assembly time-travelling shower unit and ended up in Albion in the year 23 AD. As you do. It was a very cold day, and the crew were all wrapped up in winter coats, thick socks, boots, gloves, woolly hats, the works. The cast had thick overcoats draped over their shoulders. Crichton was in need of none of these crude humanoid warming systems. -5 Celsius is just about the perfect operating temperature for a rubber-headed mechanoid. The shot we were doing was a one take. We had to arrive in the woods and start walking on a prearranged route, the cameras tracking us from a distance. We did it fairly fast and completed a few takes of the scene before returning to the warmth of the studio and hot tea, or in my case, shit tea. A few days later, we learned there was a problem with the scene. Once again, not us, not me, not the sound. This time, it was the Red Epic cameras. It seemed they didn't like the cold. Watching the footage back on a small monitor didn't show the error. In fact, you could watch it on a big monitor and not notice anything was wrong. However, as soon as you were told it's dropped frames, you'd see the little jump. I found it uniquely annoying. I was saying things like, "No one will notice," and "Surely it doesn't matter that much. One tiddly frame dropped, it seemed so minor." Naturally, everyone else thought it did matter, and rightly so. It was a disaster. We would have to shoot it again in the pickup week. All the time we'd been rehearsing episode 3, Lemons, we had been aware that a rather elaborate set was being built, where before Christmas the Quantum Twister set had been located. This was going to be the Indian Market Square, and as it came together it looked more and more amazing. A wonderful Australian production designer called Michael Ralph built all the sets for Red Dwarf 10, including this remarkable installation. We also started working with James Baxter, who was playing Jesus, another fine young actor who did us proud. Once the crew of Red Dwarf find themselves in 23 AD, they realise they have the remote for the flat-pack Swedish self-assembly time-travelling shower unit, but no battery. So being the ever-resourceful, battle-hardened space bums we are, we decide to make one using lemons. So we walk 3,000 miles across Central Europe and Asia and into India, as you do, to buy a few lemons. Once again, the background to this story was extraordinary. As Doug explained to us, the slightly bonkers theory that Judas was in fact the identical twin brother of Jesus. Judas was crucified, Jesus lived on, thus explaining the mystery of being raised from the dead. In this story, Jesus went to live and breed in the south of France, etc. I say bonkers theory, but that didn't stop Dan Brown and all the book sales for the Da Vinci Code, which, when it comes down to it, is based on much the same premise. So anyway, the set of the Indian Market, unlike any other set in the history of Red Dwarf, smelt absolutely gorgeous. My sense of smell is a bit smegged up by years of smoking. Yes, I've given up, loads of times. It's been my only physically damaging vice. All my other vices are perfectly healthy. But even with my rubber-covered proboscis, I could smell the spices piled up in beautiful brass containers all over the set. Normally, a set on Red Dwarf smells of burnt plastic, rubber, and fresh paint. This set smelled of hessian, spices, and all manner of exotic fruit. Gorgeous. We all walked around sniffing things. The set was incredibly detailed and busy, and that was before all the extras arrived. We don't often have extras in Red Dwarf, but when we were pre-recording in the Indian Market set, it was chock full of them. Lovely and very patient Indian people, dressed appropriately, stared on slightly bemused by the antics of such an odd-looking crew. We were also attired in appropriate clothing. Danny's hat naturally being a creation of rare beauty. Come the night of the live recording, we started the scene where Crichton explains how different everything was back in 23 AD. The storyline of Lemons is challenging enough when you watch the finished thing, but the audience were only party to a slightly disjointed rendering of the tale. Quite a few missing scenes and a bit of explanation from members of the cast was all they had to go on. However, a wonderful moment happened as Mr. Lister revealed his amazement at the crudity of 23 AD beliefs and culture by saying, "Jesus!" Behind him and facing away from the camera was a figure with long hair dressed in white robes. He turned around and there was young James in his Jesus wig looking like the many images painted of him over the centuries. Yes, Jesus turned unto us and gently and without judgment of mere mortals spake, "Sorry, is thou talking to me?" The audience instantly got it. They knew. They had followed the twists and turns of the story and knew who James was meant to be. It seems obvious now, but at the time it felt anything but straightforward. In case you've forgotten why we had walked all the way from the land of Albion to India, we were simply trying to build a battery for the Swedish flat-pack self-assembly time-travelling shower unit out of lemons, copper coins and galvanised nails. Obviously, we were going to meet Jesus, especially Jesus with a kidney stone. So we dine with Jesus, but he is being hunted down by Roman guards. Were there Roman guards in India in 23 AD? I don't know. Ask Doug. But there were some hulking big Roman guards chasing us. The scene where we are hiding from the guards in a storeroom and Crichton explains to Jesus the basic electrochemical theory, which takes place in a simple lemon battery, was, as you may now be able to imagine, a bit of a brain-melting moment for our rubber-headed hero. If I had worn down various kitchen floors trying to learn Crichton's speeches in the past, this one would have resulted in a 3-foot-deep trench across the room. I paced around for hours repeating it, checking the lines, starting again. The problem was, it made perfect sense. It was a very scientifically accurate description of how a battery made of lemons actually works, and I needed to be word perfect. When we were rehearsing this episode, the props crew put together the lemon battery just as it was described in the script. It was a perfect schoolroom experiment. One copper coin and one galvanized nail had been pushed into each lemon, and a short length of copper wire ran between the nail in one lemon and the coin in the next. It looked perfect, but here's the thing. Ed Moore, one of the camera operators, had a voltmeter. He put the two connectors on the ends of the wires, and he got a reading, 7.4 volts. It was a prop on Red Dwarf that actually worked. That is utterly amazing, I said.
It's not that amazing, said Craig. I think it is fairly impressive, Craigington, said Chris.
It's just a bunch of lemons and wires coming out of them, said Craig.
7.4 volts from a few lemons, that's a serious amount of electric power, I said.
Not quite enough for one of your sad little electric cows, though, Bobby, said Craig. I had to agree with him.
I'm telling you, guy, said Danny with a big saber-tooth grin, if you had, like, 4 tons of lemons, you could power Bobby's car, yeah?
The mere mention of electric cars makes Chris feel uncomfortable. I make a point of avoiding the topic when I'm in his company, but this notion filled him with glee.
4 tons of lemons. I like it, Bobbington.
As usual, Danny's crackpot suggestions often turn out to contain a surprising grain of truth. Ed Moore, the charming, but it has to be said, deeply nerdy camera operator, did a quick bit of mental maths. He worked out that there were about 2.5 lemons in a pound. 2,200 pounds in a metric ton, 1,000 kilograms. So 4 tons of lemons would be about 5,500 lemons. If 8 lemons produced 7.4 volts, then 5,500 lemons would produce around 8,800 volts, which would be enough power to instantly blow the car to bits. Obviously, if you could design a battery management system and an inverter which could control the output of the 4 tons of lemons while taking into account the possible low wattage of the system, plus design a trailer to carry the lemons, the nails and the wires, you could probably get 5 or even 6 miles of pure lemon-powered range out of an electric car pulling a massive trailer. As Ed and I discuss this, I admit slightly esoteric notion, I leave it to your imagination to picture the expression forming on Mr. Craig Charles's face as he stood close by.
I'd normally suggest you try and get out more, said Craig.
But then who'd want to meet you?
When it came to recording the scene where I explained lemon power to Jesus, who clearly couldn't understand a word of it, as he didn't even know what a lemon was, I was under considerable stress. I had finally admitted defeat at having the speech word perfect. I could make up most of it quite convincingly, but the way Doug had structured the speech was perfect. I really didn't want to make a hash of it. I therefore devised a method of having the bulk of the speech written on an idiot board I placed down on the small table on which the lemon batteries were being constructed. I half knew the speech, but having the script to hand like this gave me the confidence to dive in and go for it. Strangely, I feel some pride in this admission of pathetic failure. With the help of the cast and camera crew, the scene was completed in one take. When I watch it back, even I can't tell I'm half reading it. The editor's careful cutting around the scene with close-ups of the nails and coins being inserted into the lemons helped. But I just want to blow my very small trumpet for a moment. There, that's enough. For someone whose head is at close to thermonuclear temperatures and who has the memory of a particularly dull goldfish, I think I pulled it off. Of course, when Jesus asks, "What's a lemon?" the audience burst into laughter. It was a recurring theme for Crichton, often in scenes with Mr. Cat. Old Crichton says, "Listen," and then explains some mind-numbing but vitally important piece of space-time logic. There is a beat, and then Mr. Cat says,
"I was with you until you said listen."
Massive laugh. Typical. Lemons was great fun to do. I loved the script, and it has certainly stayed with me as a highlight of Series 10. But the production schedule was merciless. There was no laurel sitting for the boys from the Dwarf. We had one day off, and then we were back. We were ready to get entangled. The sheer weight and bulk of Craig's kebab used in the opening scene was impressive. The production team had procured it from a local kebab shop. It was a monster. It was a scene Craig clearly relished filming, and for once, as I was off camera, a scene I could enjoy watching take place. The opening scene of Entangled had to be pre-recorded due to the explosions, sparks and special effects. As Lister bit into the huge chicken Donner combo, sauce spilled out all over the control surfaces of the drive room, causing a small fire, which he naturally puts out with beer. When Rimmer discovers him, he is, as would be expected, duly appalled. But Lister reassures him that there's no need to panic, as he's got more beer. What I would like to point out, however, is the fact that Craig ate large amounts of the kebab after the scene was completed, and then went on to have a substantial lunch. I watched him chomp away as I sucked milkshake through a straw. Entangled has a classic Red Dwarf storyline and some great set pieces, most memorably for me when Crichton and the cat meet in the corridor and discover the spooky world of coincidence. This was the first scene Danny and I recorded in front of the audience that night. For some reason, I have a very clear memory of standing behind the set waiting to do this scene. At the far end of the studio, I could see Danny pacing around going over his lines. I became very still and silent. It flashed through my boiled brain that I really didn't know what I was doing, and equally important, why I was doing it. I was a 56-year-old man covered in rubber and plastic, about to record a scene that we had never once got completely right in rehearsal. Danny, as I have said many times, has a unique skill that can, at times, be complex to work with. He rarely gets anything right in rehearsals. I can say this with impunity because neither do I. However, on many occasions, what you see on the screen is a performance that none of the rest of the cast have ever seen in rehearsal. On hearing the stage manager shout action, I moved forward with a very high degree of doubt that we would ever complete the complicated scene we were about to undertake. Danny and I had to speak the same lines at the same pace with the same intonation and the same pauses between the lines. Something magical happened. For the first time, both of us were word perfect, working in a zone of harmony, and we kicked that scene out of the park. Boom! It may seem trivial in the grand scheme of things, but we were both ecstatic. It was only after it was done that I felt a huge wave of relief, realizing I had been dreading the whole evening's recording because of this one fairly short scene. The rest of the show felt like a breeze after that. Mr. Lister had been gambling with Biggs, biologically engineered garbage gobblers, not the sort of company you want to get tangled up with. Sadly, he'd lost Starbug in the bet, and as we were later to learn, he'd lost Rimmer as well. Not only that, he was now sporting a rather fetching groinal exploder, which would detonate if he reneged on the wager. Excellent stuff. All through this, Rimmer was trying to instill a bit of health and safety on board Red Dwarf by issuing Lister with reams of forms to fill in. The scene where Crichton has to inform Rimmer that the forms may, possibly, have been accidentally evacuated into deep space is one of the few times where my mucking about during rehearsals actually made it onto the screen. I have no idea what inspired it, but as we were blocking out this scene in rehearsals, Crichton was washing up cutlery when Rimmer storms in. There may well have been some fart jokes going about. If a large number of men are cooped up in a confined space for more than a few minutes, someone is going to make a fart joke. It's all part of our rich island heritage. I think I then described how Crichton doesn't fart. He has a heat outlet in his rear undercarriage, which, for no reason whatever, he started to use as a method of drying spoons. "It's all perfectly hygienic, sir," Crichton reassures Rimmer. In the entire Red Dwarf 10 series, that line was my only contribution to the script, and it was cut. Entangled was a great show to record in front of the audience, because a lot of it took place in the sleeping quarters and drive room, which were both directly in front of the seating banks. We had pre-recorded the scenes with the Beggs, because it required so many complex camera angles and costume changes. Yet again, this scene involved actors covered in rubber, foul-smelling Hessian rags, and bits of hair stuck all over the place. The Beggs chief was played by an old Red Dwarf pal, in fact an old mate of Lister's, quite literally. Steve Wickham, who we could barely recognise under his putrescent Beggs costume and makeup, had at one time played Lister's Gelf Bride in Polymorph 2. He clearly enjoyed once again being utterly unrecognisable under the piles of rags Howard Burden had draped him in. The scene where Rimmer converts to soft light to enter the stasis room on board the Erroneous Reasoning Research Academy was also pre-recorded. Lister almost dares to believe the sleeping life form is Kachansky. The description fits. It could be her. Rimmer's face reveals all as he introduces the crew to Professor Edgington. A chimp. Nice one. Oh yeah. The Erroneous Reasoning Research Academy, or ERRA for short. The speech I had been dreading since day one. It was all so straightforward. We arrive at the deserted academy, get in a lift which goes the wrong way, obviously, and as we ride to the floor containing the stasis pods, Crichton explains a brief history of the institution. It's what actors do. They get a script, they learn the lines, and then supply a performance. Notice I used the term actor then. A skilled professional who has honed their craft over many thousands of performances. Not an old numpty with a brain like a sieve who's been in a rubber mask for 10 hours and in that time has only consumed lukewarm tea and a milkshake. A member of the production crew studiously wrote out the lines in extra large letters on 4 bits of extra large card. There was no way to fit this speech on one card. I'm talking big bits of card, big letters, big clear letters you could see from 50 metres. However, in the dark of the lift set, crunched up together, all attempts at making it look like I wasn't reading were a miserable failure. We did shoot the scene in front of the audience, and just about got away with it, but it was just another bit of the show we would have to complete in the pickup week. Entangled featured 2 special guest stars, one in the guise of an uncannily realistic chimpanzee. This was brilliantly performed by Peter Elliott, who makes his living all over the world being a chimp. He's trained dozens of actors in chimp behaviour and really knows his stuff. The big advantage he has with his makeup is that he can take it off quite easily between takes. I thought I got hot, but let me tell you, chimp about for 5 minutes in a TV studio and you can create energy-generating amounts of heat. Also, Peter has 2 assistants with him at all times. Although his movements are incredibly chimp-like, he has a bit of radio-controlled assistance with the chimp's facial expressions. These were controlled by Nick Williams and Jun Matsuva, who operated the face from just behind the cameras. Even up close, if you ignore the little whiz sounds of the tiny solenoid motors working in his chimp head, it looks incredibly realistic. As usual, Crichton fathoms out that they could transform the chimp back into Professor Edgington, who was, of course, the original inventor of the groinal exploder still strapped around Lister's nethers. Although in the script she appears before us completely naked, we didn't insist on this to help us get into the scene. We may be a bunch of whacked-out space bums, but we have standards. We are gentlemen. Obviously, Crichton is the last one to notice the sheer glory of such female beauty and toddles off to get a sheep to wrap the poor professor in, only hesitating because Rimmer insists he follow relevant health and safety protocols. Anyway, Sydney was great fun to work with, and I'm glad I managed to resist telling her a naff anecdote about her dad. Well, her dad has done a bit of acting here and there over the years. Yes, okay, he's quite famous, I suppose. This fact was revealed to me in a very memorable way, and this is the story I didn't bore Sydney with during her week on The Dwarf. I'll try and keep it short, not something actors can normally be accused of. In the year 2000, I attended the premiere of a Ben Elton musical called The Beautiful Game in London's glittering West End. It was pouring with rain. As I trudged over the rather soggy red carpet, my eyes were temporarily blinded by 1,000 flash guns as a literal phalanx of paparazzi snappers started taking pictures and shouting, "Robert! Robert! Over here!" That's the price you pay for being an international megastar. I just had to deal with the pressures of fame. I was just about to stand in front of them and smile when I was gently eased out of the way by one of these smartly dressed but burly security types who stood either side of the red carpet. As I turned around, I saw the real Robert they were shouting for, Robert Lindsay, that actor bloke who is a bit on the famous side. He's also Sydney's dad. The remaining scenes were all a joy. Well, they were for me. For some reason, I knew my lines and we sailed through them. We save Lister's gentleman parts at the 11th hour and Professor Edgington trips on a pile of health and safety report forms and falls into the airlock. She obviously presses the wrong button and is sucked out into space. Job done. Rubber off, shower, change, pack small bag for weekend and head for home. 4 down, 2 to go. The following week, when we arrived in the studio, sacks of letters littered the set. One of the quirky little facts I learned on Red Dwarf 10 was that you can hire sacks of fake letters from a prop supply company. Imagine keeping boxes of fake letters on a shelf in case some production company needs a pile of letters to use in their play. It would just never occur to me that there would ever be any demand for them. But there was big demand while we were recording Dear Dave. The opening scene of this episode finds Lister down in the dumps, missing the human race. Crichton, full of the joys of cleaning, tries to cheer him up to no avail. While we were recording that opening scene in front of, as usual, a very enthusiastic crowd, I was aware of the insightful gaze of two women in the audience. One was my wife, Judy Pascoe, the other was my daughter, Holly. Before I go any further, I just want to point out that my daughter was not named after the ship's computer. She is called Holly for very different reasons. It's a long story, and I'm not going to go off on that particular tangent. Suffice it to say, she is a very different Holly. She actually does have quite a high IQ, and she's frighteningly sensible and grown up. As in any family, there has to be a certain amount of tolerance between husband and wife. I tolerate the fact that my missus is alarmingly clever, emotionally mature, calm, sensible, kind, gentle, and patient. She tolerates the fact that I'm loud, cheap, shallow, vain, sweary, hypocritical, emotionally unstable, immature, and moody. One area where she can be a little bit prickly is when she assesses my performances, either on stage or TV. I was nervous about her seeing me as Crichton again. It had been over 20 years since Judy donned a rubber mask and played Camille. However, she is one of the few people who knows what it's really like. Being an Australian and growing up in quite a macho culture, she has three enormous brothers, she's not prone to overly sympathising with a shallow actor type who moans on about being hot. I'm happy and proud to announce that after the recording that night, Judy and Holly came into the makeup room as I was being de-rubbered. Judy said, "Well done, Dahl, you were quite good tonight. You even remembered some of your lines." That, ladies and gentlemen, is praise indeed. One of the pre-recorded scenes we did for Dear Dave was when the cat wants to tell the rest of the Red Dwarf crew something important but decides to do it in charades. There was a loose script for this scene, but Doug encouraged us to do it off the page, make it up as we go along. Of course, Danny was on fire with his physical antics, leaving us utterly baffled by what he was trying to say. Rimmer was obsessed with a giant death worm, Crichton was fearful of being replaced by a superior mechanoid, and Lister is just trying to make sense of Cat's insane mime skills. We often descended into hysterics as both Danny's mime and our responses became more and more absurd. It turns out Mr. Cat was trying to tell us a mail pod had crashed into his washing line that was hanging in a cargo deck. I long to see a scene where the cat looks after his enormous wardrobe. It's never been seen on Red Dwarf, but clearly he does all his own laundry, something I'm sure Crichton would be a little bit put out by. So Lister gets a letter from Hayley Summers, a long-lost lover, who informs him she is pregnant and doesn't know if Lister is the father. This episode contains a scene with Lister and Cat that proved yet again Danny can pull something out of the hat that none of us had ever seen before. We all know Danny well enough to believe that on the night he'll deliver. Boy, did he deliver that night. I watched Craig and Danny rehearse the scene where the cat tries to get Lister to stop thinking about Hayley Summers, who worked in the bank, by painting vivid pictures of what she did with Roy and his finger-wetting machine. It never went well. Craig always ended up looking a bit despondent. Danny was all over the place, and I'm generally laughing way too much, which doesn't help. I admit to having been quite tense on the night when they started recording this scene. I'd had time to drop some of my costume and stand at the side of the studio to cool down with various members of the crew. A large monitor on a stand allowed us to see the scene taking place. Danny enters. It all goes well, but my toes are curled up in my Crichton boots in case the whole thing grinds to a halt. Craig is brilliant, underplayed and confident all the way through. And Danny hits every line spot on. The audience loved it. It was like watching a well-oiled machine that had been running perfectly for years. I'm sure no one watching that night had any clue that this was, for all intents and purposes, the first time any of us, including Danny and Craig, had ever experienced the whole scene in one go. Amazing. Of course, I'm forgetting the vending machines and Lister's slightly dodgy relationship with Dispensing Machine 32. Okay, I'll admit Crichton has always had a bit of a soft spot for 32, but she is such a flirt with her shiny logo and clean dispensing tray. Most disconcerting. Witnessing Rimmer's face when he catches Lister trying to heave Dispenser 32 into an upright position sent me straight back to my first ever series in 1989 when I was trying to remove Lister's shrinking boxer shorts and the immortal line, "You'll bonk anything, Lister," which Craig and I couldn't hear due to the audience screaming with laughter. Blimey, we've been doing this show for a long time. After the makeup was removed, the studio was closed down for the weekend. I returned home to try and rest before the final week's live recording, when we would start the beginning. Somehow, in all the chaos, the scripts, the set changes and line learning, it didn't feel like the last episode. By the time we got to the beginning, we were all right in the Red Dwarf groove. It completely takes over your life. I was getting emails and messages about other things I was involved in, but it all had to wait. The dwarf is all-powerful. The dwarf must be obeyed. The dwarf owns your life. The big scene in the beginning, which took a lot of preparation and had to be pre-recorded, was when Hoagie the Rogie gets into the sleeping quarters and challenges Lister to a duel across time and space. Richard O'Callaghan, who played the Creator in Back to Earth, returned in a slightly different guise as Hoagie. As far as suffering under makeup goes, Richard deserves the medal in this episode. He couldn't really see anything. He looked amazing, but boy, that took some serious glue and paint to achieve. Many long hours in the makeup chair, but Richard is a proper actor and never complained. Hoagie reveals a map he's stolen from some rogue simulants. He doesn't accept that he might have been followed. He thinks he's been as clever as a hedgehog and outwitted the evil killer rogue simulants moments before a rogue simulant death ship fires a bunch of missiles at Red Dwarf. A breach in the hull, as any hardened space bum knows, can be a bit of a problem. The air in Red Dwarf gets sucked out into the void of space. Everything gets messy and it takes ages to tidy it all up. Most annoying. To create this sequence, we had to use some fairly powerful wind machines. Interestingly, when we used wind machines back in 1989, when I had my eyes glued open and soap flakes blasted into them as I pulled Mr. Cat along on a sleigh, the wind machines were powered by Volkswagen Beetle engines, air-cooled as any decent car nerd would know. Now they are powered by electric motors. I'm not saying this because I firmly believe we are seeing the beginning of the end of the internal combustion engine. And don't tell Chris Barry I said this, but we are seeing the beginning of the end of the internal combustion engine. Anyway, that said, even if it is powered by a beefy but quiet electric motor, a big wind machine still makes a lot of noise. It's all to do with the propeller tips nearly reaching the speed of sound. I've explained it on Scrap Heap Challenge and done voiceovers about it on How Do They Do It. Spin a propeller fast enough and it's deafening. Everything in the set was sent swirling around. We were shouting at the top of our lungs, but still couldn't be heard above the din. In the middle of the chaos, Crichton enters to tidy Lister's quarters, but doesn't realise he has company. He then asks for his scheduled lesson in human modes of speech, all shouted at maximum volume. I could only guess my cue from watching Craig's mouth. I couldn't hear a word he said. We had to record the scene again and again, as quite often large parts of the set would collapse or come away in our hands. Years of practice at horrendous, catastrophic spaceship trauma acting had meant we were very good at grabbing onto something and flailing around. A few of the things I grabbed onto, like a wall, came away in the chaos, resulting in a reshoot. Also, it said in the script that Hoagie's comb-over gets blown over the wrong way. Just that. Simple. There's a wind machine. There's Hoagie with his tragic simulant comb-over, bada-boom, bada-bing, nothing. For some reason, even with all the wind and flying debris, Hoagie's comb-over stayed resolutely in place. Bring out the leaf blower, electric, and point it at the comb-over from 2 inches away. Only that amount of staggeringly powerful and focused wind could cause the comb-over to give up the ghost and flop to one side as only a comb-over can. I feel sorry for young people these days. When I was a lad, a comb-over was a common sight. You'd be walking down a street with your teenage pals and you'd see a man with a comb-over, cue much snickering and pointing. They were such ridiculous attempts that bald men made to pretend they still had hair. I remember waiting for a bus once on the Caledonian Road in Islington. It was a very windy day. A man I'd seen before was waiting for the bus too. He had a truly tragic swirl around the back, plenty of Brill Cream stuck down on the bald head type comb-over. It looked hysterically tragic. As the bus approached, the sudden change in wind direction and an extra gust caused the carefully applied side hair comb-over to lift up like a bin lid. I don't think he noticed. Back in the late 1970s, there were more than a handful of well-known TV personalities, newsreaders, sports pundits, all sporting comb-overs. Oh, how I miss those heady days. Back in the studio, we got to watch some other very fine actors ply their trade, particularly Gary Cady as Dominator Zlurth and Alex Hardy as the brilliantly funny Chancellor Wednesday. His accidental Harry Carey moment was pure joy to witness. Although we didn't have any scenes directly with the rogue simulants, it was great fun watching them work. Another part of The Beginning we never saw recorded was the Rimmer flashback sequence, when Rimmer is caught out by his overbearing father in the schoolroom. Great stuff. That's always a thrill on recording night. We gather around a monitor, sometimes even squash between people in the audience seating, and watch the pre-recorded sequences. Most of the scenes we shot in front of the audience for the final show were in the drive room set, rapidly converted to be the interior of Blue Midget. By this late stage in the series, as always seems to be the case, budget restrictions, as in we've spent all the money, required some creative tailoring of what we already had. The final sequence was total chaos. We hadn't rehearsed the scene, we didn't even have a script until the middle of the week. For reasons that were not clear to us during the recording, not only was Doug directing, producing and shooting the series, he was also rewriting scripts during the night. Many of the first draft scripts, which we never saw, had to be dumped because of budget restrictions. Doug is nothing if not ambitious. He'd probably written episodes that required 10,000 extras and needed to be shot in post-apocalyptic Los Angeles. Strangely, we couldn't quite afford to do that. So all the way through the series, there were rewrites, amendments, and cuts, which often didn't get to us until the last moment. On the night of recording the last episode, these were slightly after the last moment. The audience that night were the only ones to witness the mildly tragic sight of seeing Crichton don his robo-glasses and read the scene from the script, each of us acting out the sequence as best we could. Amazingly, seeing four middle-aged men in ridiculous costumes reading a script didn't seem to diminish the audience's response. They laughed and clapped just as hard. "Hey, Dougie," said Craig after the recording, "we could save a shitload of money if we just did Red Dwarf as a radio play. Even Bobby could keep up if he's got his specs on." Doug laughed through the pain. The final episode was done. Well, most of the final episode was done. All we had now was the pickup week. Ah, yes, the pickup week. The deep joy the memory of the pickup week brings back to me. In a normal week on Red Dwarf, I will wear the mask for 2 days. A long day when we pre-record and a shorter but much more intense day when we record the live show. During the pickup week, it's one long mask-a-thon. I stayed in the hotel in Shepperton with Craig during the week because after a day in the mask, my eyes sort of give up working and just become swollen slits where my eyes normally are. We'd become regulars in the hotel bar. The locals would stop by and have a chat. I'd sip a small glass of red wine and Craig would have something a little stronger. Then we'd wander off through the bitterly cold night to a truly fabulous Shepperton curry house, stuff our faces with, in my case, a mild chicken korma, and in Craig's case, a specially prepared mutton vindaloo with a bit of extra chilli to give it some pep. I only had to sniff Craig's exquisite-looking dish, and my already swollen eyes would start to tear up, and it wasn't because I felt sad for the curry. That stuff could be used for rocket fuel. We then stumble back to the hotel, go to bed early because long, long before it got light, we'd be back on the dwarf. On one of those stumbles back to the hotel, Craig was on a roll. I wish I could remember exactly what it was he said. I know it was very funny because I was resting on all fours trying to get my breath back. I had laughed myself into an exhausted state of collapse. I think he simply repeated a profoundly offensive joke. He had to repeat it because I'm so rubbish at one-liner jokes I often don't get it. I have a very clear memory of looking at the damp Shepperton pavement from very close up, tears streaming down my face, all decorum lost to the hysterical laughter that racked my old frame. He is a very funny man. At the same time I was on my hands and knees in a Shepperton side street, Mr. Barry was out on a floodlit field playing football. Incredible. We'd been slogging away in the studio all day, and after work, he gets in his kit, I'm sure Chris will have all the right equipment, and he plays football against teams half his age. I know many ladies find Chris very attractive, and so they should. He is a very fit chap, but before you get too interested, ladies, Chris is a very happily married man. Danny would have been at home with his two very young children. In terms of relaxing, chilling, kicking back and all those other things people like to do, having two young children puts a bit of a crimp on such relaxing pastimes. No doubt Doug was rewriting a scene we were due to shoot the following day and reviewing the scenes we'd shot that day and making decisions about the budget and the costumes and the PR stuff and the photo shoot we were due to do and deciding about the set, the lights and the camera angles. Yeah, but I was busy laughing at one of Craig's most profoundly offensive jokes, and that takes a lot of energy and commitment. So, in the pickup week, we did rather a lot. The studio was split in two with a giant black curtain separating off a large section of the floor space. Behind this curtain, a team was recording the model shots, including a newly refurbished model of Red Dwarf. We all had a look at this amazing model, originally made by the sadly missed Peter Ragg. In the olden days of telly, the model would have been hanging on wires and would then be moved past the static camera. In the modern world, the model is mounted on a black post with black curtains behind it, and the camera is moved past the model on a complex camera rig. I have to say that although all the shots of spaceships, rogue simulant death ships, red dwarf, blue midget, etc. are actually models, because the cameras are so good, it almost looks like CGI. Sure, there are some CGI tweaks added after the original footage has been shot, explosions, etc., but they still don't look like the Thunderbirds quality of the old Starbug sequences. I know it doesn't matter in the grand scheme of things, but I love those shots. Of course, we had to reshoot the exterior scene from Lemons, where we walked through the winter woodlands of Shepperton. This time we kept the cameras warm enough, and it all went very well. We shot some green screen moments from the beginning, where the missiles from the rogue simulant ships pass through the hull of Blue Midget after Lister has fired the Wibbly gun, or more correctly described as the molecular destabilizer gun, sir. In fact, in the pickup week, we did a ridiculous amount. Some of it made sense to us, some of it was utterly baffling. Jim Imber, our relentlessly energetic and positive first assistant director, would just say, "Walk in there, Robert. Look shot. Turn around and walk out, taking the files with you. And action." Not a great deal of rehearsal time. No chance for me to say, "But Jim, what's my emotional motivation in this scene? I'm really not feeling it." The days blurred together, but on the final day, with a list of pickup shots that seemed to go on forever, the whole studio was alive with energy. I do not know how we did it, but everyone pulled out all the stops, and finally, after what seemed like a month of pickup shots, Jim shouted, "It's a wrap!" Red Dwarf 10 was on multiple hard drives, backed up and secure. As far as the cast were concerned, it was done. We'd shot everything. As far as Doug was concerned, it was half done. In fact, as far as we were all concerned, it was 99% done, because a few weeks after we'd finished, when I was in the middle of shooting a new series of Fully Charged, I had to go round to a sound engineer's studio and re-record the dialogue from the simulant attack scene with the wind machines. All you could hear on the soundtrack was a thundering racket with a few shouty sounds in the background. I admit I did feel a right numpty standing in a quiet studio with headphones on doing shouty talking, but after a few attempts it all seemed to hold together. What was exciting, though, was seeing a scene completed. Although it's obvious I have seen every moment of a new Red Dwarf, it doesn't actually feel like it until you've been able to watch a sequence on a big screen. All the way through the process, we had all, I think it's fair to say, had a background anxiety that this new series wouldn't be as good as the ones we'd made back in the last century. Watching that short sequence started to wear away that anxiety. This looked good. 3 months later, a package arrived for me in the mail. Doug had warned me it was coming, so as I eagerly ripped open the small box, I knew what was inside. 6 DVDs, the final edit and broadcast version of Red Dwarf 10, complete with the opening titles and end credits. DVDs. Old school. I'd moved on in my technology. I live in a download world. I stream video across multiple devices in a totally wireless environment. I'm cutting edge, baby, which means nothing works very well and I get frustrated and give up. I dug out an old computer that had a quaint old DVD drive in the side. Sat down, headphones on, cup of tea, sorted. Over 3 hours later, I emerged, goggled-eyed and overwhelmed. I was amazed not only by what we'd all accomplished as a team, but by what Doug and the editors had managed to create with the raw material. It really lifted my spirits. The future was looking good for the small rouge one. By the end of September, I was getting tweets from all over the UK. People had started spotting posters in train stations, tube stations, and even on big poster sites on the street. Craig sent me a text containing a picture of a poster in Manchester. He'd seen it on his way to work on Coronation Street.
"A brand new smegging series," said the strapline.
This kind of promotion had never happened when we were on the BBC. On October the 3rd, we gathered for a press launch and public viewing. I say we. Sadly, Danny was still in Guadeloupe filming Murder in Paradise with Ben Miller. Getting all the dwarfy space bums together in one place at one time is always incredibly difficult. In a small and very chaotic hotel room near Leicester Square, we all gathered together and got transformed into our characters. We then walked down the street, which, it has to be noted, caused a small amount of bafflement to the passing tourists and delivery van drivers. We turned into Leicester Square and were confronted by a proper gaggle of photographers, all of whom were shouting, "Over here! On the left! In the middle!" all at once. About 20 minutes later, we went back to the hotel and got de-dwarfed. I don't think I've ever had the makeup on for less time. Even when we've done makeup tests and camera tests, I have it on longer. Doug, Craig, Chris, myself, and what seemed like 20 other people then crammed into another room and did a few interviews over a speakerphone. We had a very hurried supper and headed for the Prince Charles Cinema, where the first episode was going to be shown to a packed house. I had quite a few friends attending. Nigel Planer, Lisa Rogers, and many other people I'd worked with were in the auditorium, and I never saw them. It was all a bit busy. The preview went down a storm. Everyone seemed to love it. We did a short question and answer session afterwards, and I was immensely grateful Doug was there, as many of the questions about plot development and storylines were dealt with by the man who knows. I just waffle when I'm asked. My son and his supermodel girlfriend were in the audience. She'd never seen Red Dwarf before, and she said she loved it. Nice. I asked my son what he thought. "Yeah, not bad. Can you lend me £20, Dad, yeah?" Nice. The following night, I sat down with my daughter and watched the episode as it went out. We'd had a takeaway curry beforehand. I helped her do a history homework about Pitt the Younger and George III's influence over Parliament in 1785, but by 9 p.m. we were ready. My daughter laughed. She actually laughed when Crichton gets a bit angry with the Droid Shopping Channel customer service complaints department. "That was actually funny, Dad," she said, and gave me a pat on the back. Nice. So, what next for the small rouge one? I don't know. I thought it was all over after Series 3 back in 1989. So I'm keeping my options open.